This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. Whether you're a beginner or a seasoned professional, No Wave Academy is your ultimate educational resource to help bring your artistry to the next level. Our renowned roster of instructors include Nick Runge, Mia Bergeron, Sean Cheatham, Kate Zambrano, David Chaffetz, Paul Christina, John Wentz, and many more. Some of these artists have appeared on this very podcast, while others have been featured in exhibitions at the No Wave Gallery and museums around the world. Here at No Wave Academy, we believe that everyone has a unique artistic expression. With guidance, experience, and the proper tools, students have the ability to invigorate and elevate their work. Unlock and unblock your inner creative voice. Join us and walk into the next chapter of your personal artistic evolution. Go to nowaveacademy.com, type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. That's nohwaveacademy.com. Now, onto the episode. Hey everyone, welcome to Artist Decoded. I'm your host Yoshino, and my guest for today is cartoonist Liana Finck. She is a regular contributor at The New Yorker magazine. She's also a recipient of a Fulbright Fellowship and a New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship. She has an upcoming gallery exhibit at Blue Gallery in Midtown East, which is in New York City, and it opens this Saturday, August 21st. And will be up for a week. To me, her work speaks about her interactions and observations. It speaks about the way she intakes her surroundings and environment living in a big city. And I find that her work is very relatable because she creates comics that depict people in real life situations. It shows an honesty that most people wouldn't express outwardly, emotions that people feel on a daily basis but may not say out loud. Maybe because people have been trained to be too polite to express the way they truly feel, or maybe we don't want to hurt someone else's feelings. But then I think about the times when we're not true to ourselves in these situations and how we can lie to ourselves by the sheer desire to want to fit in. I feel like Liana has captured something that is poignant and heartfelt. Her work speaks about the absurdity of our human experiences. I also enjoy the playfulness in her work too. Her drawings are loose and quick, but the mixture of her sketches with the subject matter that she tackles gives a well-balanced and well-intentioned feeling to her work. And a book of hers that I'd like to recommend is Excuse Me, Cartoons, Complaints, and Notes to Self. Or if you want to view her work online, you can find her work at lianafink.com, or you can find her on Instagram. All right, so here it is, my conversation with cartoonist Liana Finck. Hope you enjoy it. Well, thanks. Yeah, thanks for taking the time to do this. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks. Well, in an article you were talking about, you said, "I was a real artist until I turned 11. And I just found that to be really interesting just because I personally really enjoy the artwork of children just because it's so unadulterated and it's...
Yeah, no pun intended.
Yeah, exactly. No pun intended. It's the literally the definition of being unadulterated. And yeah, I don't know. It's just, you know, there's, you know, like Bruce Lee talks about martial arts being an honest expression of himself. And, you know, I think that he even talks about how it's really hard for people to be honest with themselves. And I just found that to be really fascinating. So I was wondering what you meant when you said, "I was a real artist until I turned 11.
I think that's what I meant. I think, I don't know, maybe when I was 11 or so, I started, well, I think the main thing is being judged on whether you're good or bad. I think before then, I was called an artist and a good artist, mostly because I just drew all the time and I made stuff all the time. And then once you get older and people start learning craft and expecting you to learn craft, there's there's such a thing as a good or bad artist instead of just an artist. And I think that was the main thing. That was the beginning of me censoring myself to in a certain way. I think I always censored. I've always been kind of a perfectionist, even when I was a little kid. But I think it came from within at first, and then suddenly I was trying to please others. And it took a long time to unlearn that. And art school did not help.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting kind of common misconception, is that people think that by going to art school that they'll come out with some sort of catharsis or some sort of idea as to how they want to approach their career and their life. But sometimes, you know, I guess it depends what sort of artist you want to be, but sometimes it actually takes away from who you maybe naturally are by teaching you all these techniques that you can use in a certain sense, but may actually work against you. But what do you think about that?
Yeah, I agree. I've never heard of all these different techniques and forms of art. When I was younger, I grew up like with a lot of art, but also very sheltered from other people who made art. I went to very small schools without real art classes, so I was really the only kid who drew for a long time. When I was older, I realized that there was a difference between cartooning and fine art, and that certain things qualified as like fine art or good art or serious art, and certain things didn't. And I never had a really good grasp of what those things were, but I think because I didn't have a good grasp, I cared a lot that I made the serious kind of art. I made really, really bad work in college. I'm not sure if it was totally that or if it was just that I'm really bad with materials, but it wasn't working for me.
Bad in the sense that it didn't fall into the box that fine art puts on someone that is trying to approach fine art, or bad in the sense that you didn't understand exactly what you were trying to create?
Bad in that I think I didn't have good reasons for making what I made. I was trying to make the kind of things that my teachers and the other students at school would think was good art, but it didn't really come from my heart. And also, I didn't try to learn any of the techniques. I just kind of like hand-fisted, went and tried to make an oil painting or tried to make a video. And I think being very intuitive works with most of those crafts until you've put a lot of time into learning them. And I wasn't mature enough to know that. I've gotten better with craft as I've gotten older, but it's not a natural thing for me. My oil paintings were so bad. I just moved and I found an old invitation to one of my college shows on a postcard, and it's so sad. The picture is so sad.
What can you describe it to the audience? Oh, and to me.
Yeah. First of all, it was, I think it had like an artificial patina that I put on in Photoshop. I was also trying to learn Photoshop and also trying to be fancy about that. And it has also faded over the years. So it's very, very yellow and not a pleasant yellow. And it's a picture of, I was always kind of cartoony and representational, but I always kind of tried to like sneak it in there and make it look very serious and really overwork it. So it's a dog with two heads, I think. I don't know why. Like, I don't think I found it funny. I think I just had to make something representational. And I think maybe one is a horse and one is a dog. And it's really muddy. There's a lot of swirls in the sky. It's like kind of red and green and like very overworked. One of the creatures looks like it has these giant pimples on it that are not intentional. And the words are kind of placed in a way that look like I'm trying to pass a Photoshop test.
But I think that's really interesting too, because you can look back on that particular artwork, and obviously, you know, I haven't seen what this looks like, but you can look back on that and understand what the feelings that you're going through, and the sort of, there's certain things that I like to call that you can tie to like a religious sense, like secondhand values. So it's like values.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So Yeah, it's like values that, you know, people put down upon you. And yeah, it's like just thinking about, you know, maybe a typical college professor, you know, maybe the way that they're teaching you is like within this sort of rigid box, and because they're in this rigid academic structure, they feel like they need to, it's almost like people becoming a caricature of like a teacher rather than like actually teaching you something useful, you know? So I don't know.
Yeah, I think maybe different like modes of making art aren't as rigid as we pretend they are. And we need to pretend that there's such a thing as oil painting and, I don't know, fine art in general in order to teach it in schools. Teaching is hard.
Yeah, no, definitely. You know, something that I came across recently that I thought that was really interesting, and as I was, you know, doing some research for this conversation with you, is I was watching this Philip Glass interview, and he was talking about finding a voice creatively is a huge issue for some people. And he was saying that, you know, finding a voice by the age of 30 is generally when it happens. And he was just making, obviously, a generalization.
That makes sense to me.
Yeah, but the thing that I found really interesting, and I'll quote him right here, he said, the real issue is not when do you get your voice, but how do you break out of it? It's only when you get to that point is when the real discovery and journey begins.
Wow.
And that was so that was so profound to me because, and literally recently, you know, I came across this interview and I was just thinking about that because, you know, you were talking about, I was, you know, watching an interview on you, and you were talking about your first book. Well, technically it was your second book, the 2014 book, A Bintel Brief.
Bintel Brief. Yeah. What was my first book?
Well, when I looked up the, I don't know. I mean, yeah, obviously correct me if I'm wrong, but.
It's self-published Revelations was. It was brilliant. You know, I don't know why I said but some people will know when you are hired to do an illustration job and it's not your idea and it is not something you really understand and you do it because it's work. But yeah. And as part of the payment, the publisher is like, oh, we can't pay you a lot, but we'll give you an author credit. So for the young listeners, you don't need to take that as an author credit. Like, it's not your book, and having an author credit isn't really, it won't bring you any glory. Anyway, it was an illustration gig.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
Yeah.
So then would you consider A Bintel Brief to be your first book?
I would consider A Bintel Brief to be my second book because I self-published one when I was 21, that no one will ever read.
Okay. So you were talking about your second book, A Bintel Brief. And I was just thinking about that because you were saying in this interview that you didn't really have a style then. And, you know, looking back, I mean, that was 7 years ago. So looking back, like, what do you think about that now?
Yeah, I think some people's style, especially younger people, is the style of, I don't know, just kind of exploring style. Bintel Brief is a series of short comics, each based on a different letter written into a Yiddish advice column in the very early 1900s. And I drew each one in a different style, like slightly different style, ostensibly to give each character a different voice, but really because I was learning how to draw comics and trying out different things. And I think I'd have more fun exploring now, actually, because I have more confidence. Like as Philip Glass said, I have a voice and you need kind of a jumping off point in order to leave. You need a voice to leave in order to explore new voices. So my exploration early on was pretty conservative. But yeah, I can tell that. So I draw very fast now, and I can tell from Bintel Brief, like just looking at it, that I was drawing slow in each of these different styles. And that was from a lack of confidence. So I think not having a voice is just kind of not having confidence and not having kind of a personal shorthand of things that you could just take for granted as you, like, fluency, so you could concentrate on what you have to say. But I don't think not having a voice is bad at all. I think a lot of good work comes when you, when you're not so confident. There's, it's interesting to explore voice itself.
Yeah, I like to think about it too in terms of, as some people would call it, naive work or naive art.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Yeah, and sometimes it's, well, I don't know, you know, like, you know, you say certain things and it's like, well, what do I actually really know, right? Like, but, you know, when people point towards naive work, you know, I think the romanticization is really that, you know, people like these, this specific group of people are like outsiders and they don't really work in the confines of like the fine art world. So they're not indulgent upon the fact that, you know, this world exists and yada, 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 you know, but.
There's also like, I don't know if what I'm going to talk about is naive work per se, but like there's this kind of in art school or just out of art school work where that I've noticed, I don't know if I'm probably even generalizing too much. I noticed it in myself and I noticed it in other people who went to my college. To Cooper Union, is that when they're making work, like in the few years out of college and maybe after, like they have such a sense of if it's not perfect, then it's not good at all. And if it is perfect, I won't have to market it at all. So I don't know, but there's just a certain personality type of like not of perfectionism, but there's also a certain quality to the work where it's very fine. And it's very fine. And I don't have that anymore. And I don't miss it because it wasn't fun for me. And it's not really who I'm supposed to be, but other people do it better than I did. And it makes for some good work sometimes.
Well, yeah, I think it's interesting just to think of, or just to view people that have very rigid or very like perfectionist sort of work, you know, because that may or may not say something about the human psyche, like how perfect you need things to be or how perfect you need things to be like in your regular daily life. And, you know, life isn't perfect. Life can be kind of terrible sometimes, you know, but doesn't necessarily mean that it's terrible all the time, but it's,
why is art the one thing that has to be perfect? Like where you have to get an A+, like I'm sure the people who try to get an A+ in art aren't also trying to get an A+ in having their house clean or in being perfectly happy or in being activist or like any of the stuff you could really strive to do perfectly. And like, we're all, if you could get a B in any of those things, you're doing so well. I think art should be that way too.
Yeah. And I mean, failing at something or what you would deem to be a failure at that particular time may lead you to a more perfectly imperfect understanding of how you would actually like to be. You know, like those sort of quote unquote failures give you a certain perspective along the way to be able to like maybe be more you, you know?
I wonder if that's what it is to have a voice, if it means you're so confident that you don't mind failing and you're not second guessing every syllable that comes out of your mouth.
Maybe. When I think of voice, I think about rhythm and consistency. So whether whether you think about that like on the aesthetic level or, you know, when people point to someone for a specific style, whether it's in art or whether it's in, you know, this communication style, you know, it's a rhythm to the way that you speak or the rhythm to the way in which you draw or you make films or something. So, but then going back to the Philip Glass thing, I think like, well, when do you break that rhythm? You know, like at what point are you becoming a caricature of yourself? And then you need to break out of that to discover something new.
Yeah. I think there's more freedom in being a consistent comics artist than in being a consistent fine artist. I think I'm definitely biased and I'm probably wrong, but I think that if someone like Dan Klaus like draws people's faces the same every time he draws faces, he still has so much to explore. Like he still has story to explore and the way he sets up the page, and that's enough. And like if you want to do autopilot with like how you draw faces, that's a necessary thing to do. But on the other hand, if you're Rothko, you might get pretty bored exploring color in large emotional rectangles every day, all your life.
Hmm. Well, that makes sense. I mean, what you just said in terms of some of the ideas that you put out there with your work, because you have a very consistent, at least like the past couple of years and from what I've seen, a very consistent style in terms of the aesthetic in which you draw, but you explore all these various modes of feeling and how that is categorized in different like subjects. So it's like relationships and, you know, just like life observations and those sort of things. Actually, I was curious, like I was watching this video of you and you were doing these illustrations, and I think it was like the title of it is What We Say and What We Mean.
Oh yeah. That was Pop Up Magazine, RIP-ish. I think they're still around in some way. It was this performance series based in Oakland and it was so magnificent.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I found that to be really interesting just because, yeah. And a day-to-day scenario, especially in, you know, bigger cities, like I live in Los Angeles and you live in New York, but in these bigger cities, you know, dare I say this, but there's probably a larger amount of like sociopaths in like bigger cities. Maybe it's because of like survival methods and people have to like, you know, kind of be cutthroat or whatever. Maybe that's built into the capitalistic system as well.
I came here to get away from the sociopath. Although that's armchair psychologist thing. I probably mean I came here to get away from the closed-minded, normal, boring people. I don't know. Because you're probably right if you mean people who are able to divide themselves into many selves and compartmentalize.
Hmm. Well, I mean, from my understanding of the definition of a sociopath, for instance, like I think a psychopath, I could be getting this wrong, but a psychopath, for instance, is someone who tries to manipulate a scenario and like is cognizant that they're doing it, you know? And I think the difference between a sociopath and a psychopath is that a psychopath is premeditated and a sociopath is just, that's kind of like part of their personality. I mean, I'm no psychologist, so I might have to look that up later or people might have to correct me on that, but.
Yeah, I love it. I think you're right in that case. I think cities are full of people who are able to control their own and other people's destinies in a way that's somewhere between socially adept and scary.
Hmm. Yeah.
Okay,
so,
come on, sorry.
Oh yeah, no, it's fine. No, I guess I wanted to explore that, the idea of what we say and what we mean. And like, it's, you know, just from viewing your work in general, it seems like you observe a lot of people in a lot of scenarios and also make a lot of certain observations about yourself. And I'm curious what you meant by that, like, you know, or your certain observation of like what we say versus what we mean.
That's so interesting that you would think of the people who are able to mean something other than they say, a kind of pathology, because I think of myself who can't do that very well as a kind of pathology. I very much admire people who are able to tell white lies, and I'm always trying to learn how to do it better, because I think of it as just like how we function in society, which is something I'm very, very interested in and not very good at. So I ask my mom a lot of questions. I feel a little sorry for her that she has to field so many, but I'm always asking her like, I have 23 hours before this hangout that a person didn't commit to exactly. I really like, having plans in advance. Is 23 hours like can I cancel even though I'm not, even is it too late to cancel even though I'm not fully committed yet because they didn't say definitely yes? It's like the Gemara or something. And I think I'm learning from my mom and just from being alive in a city how to speak in code and get what I need without hurting people's feelings. But I don't think I'm someone who naturally likes to hurt people's feelings. I think I'm naturally someone who just doesn't get what she needs. I don't say what I mean. I say nothing because I'm afraid of that saying what I mean will hurt people's feelings. But I'm learning gradually how to say something slightly different from what I mean that will have the same net result as saying what I mean. Like, I'm not someone who would say, I don't want to hang out with you because you were too vague and it made me anxious, so I'm canceling. Instead, I would naturally just wait for the person to make the plan 5 minutes before I'm going to see them and be a nervous wreck the whole day before. But I'm learning very, very gradually how to do something such as tell the person 23 hours before our hangout, oh, I'm so sorry, something just came up. I feel sick, or I have a new freelance assignment, so that I know I'm doing it because the plans didn't solidify soon enough for me, but they don't take it personally.
I think, yeah, a lot of us try to navigate those certain things because, I mean, it could just be a social evolutionary thing or a social evolutionary psychological thing where you don't want to let people down, but you also want to have boundaries for yourself in terms of, you know, what is acceptable behavior for you in terms of planning things ahead of time.
It's so tricky. I'm so curious if, like, most people do more of this than I do, and just it just comes naturally to them to kind of manipulate others a little bit in order to get what they need, or if people in general have fewer needs than I have and they don't mind a last minute hangout, or there are so many things that I mind.
Yeah.
I never know.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, and then it's then the thing that you have to think about, or the thing that I would think about in that scenario is, you know, how close am I to that person?
Would you let a person closer to you get away with more, or would you be more honest with them?
Oh, I'd definitely be more direct.
Yeah, I would too, because it'll come up again.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I think sometimes we do ourselves a disservice by believing that someone has similar values to you in terms of time management, or yeah. And then so that's how the disconnect can occur, because you don't tell them my boundary is this. I mean, I've definitely had to tell that to, you know, friends of mine that maybe it could be, you know, maybe they're a director, a film director, and they're used to having people cater to them in terms of their time and their needs and those sort of things. But I find that it's actually more beneficial to say, look, I've noticed this is a pattern. You've done this multiple times. And, you know, it makes me frustrated, you know, so I want you to think about that and what that means for our friendship. And sometimes to have those conversations, I think, can be really hard, because social evolutionary psychology teaches us that we've evolved in a way to where we don't want to be ostracized from the community. So if we bring up something that is bad about, or could be perceived to be bad about someone, and you're pointing something out about them, then they might take it offensive and not want to talk to you. So from a basic standpoint, you know?
Yeah. There's so many people who, I don't even think it's selfishness, but I feel like I'm in the wrong generation for when it comes to planning, because so many people seem to really just like live minute to minute.
How much do you think though that is part of the surroundings and the environment that has shaped New York?
I don't know. Do you feel that differently in New York than in other places? Is New York more of a last minute place?
That's interesting. I mean, I've never lived in New York, but I would be there for weeks at a time, and I would go to New York maybe, you know, 6 times a year. But whenever I'm there, my intention is more so like business and meetings and those sort of things, you know? So I don't know what it's like on a daily basis.
Yeah.
And it's more hearsay, you know?
Yeah. Have you heard that about New York?
Yeah. I mean, you know, a lot of people talk about that in terms of the difference between New York and Los Angeles, where New York is much more like, you know, that typical saying, like the New York minute, right? And how everything is so much more fast paced.
Yeah, it's rushed. I feel like the most rushed person I know. Like, I'm very scheduled. Like, you need a lot of free time to be able to just make a plan last minute. Although I think you either need more free time or you need a very thick skin and to be able to cancel, to just like not do something you kind of said you would do. Hurt some feelings.
Yeah.
I miss flying. Do you miss coming here a lot?
I don't know. I'm at a much different point in my life where, I think you and I are about the same age. I'm about to be 35 in September.
Yeah, welcome.
welcome.
A year older than you.
Yeah.
It's been good.
Yeah. Year. Yeah. So I don't know. Maybe it's the difference of that and, you know, moving to somewhere that's more rural or, for instance, I took the, Myers-Briggs recently and, this is the first time I'm still in the middle, but this is the first time that I got, it being an introvert.
Ooh, wow. I don't know if I've ever taken the Myers-Briggs.
Oh, really?
You know, it's made by a mother and daughter.
Oh, they were. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
There's a free one that you can take online. I mean, there's a couple of free ones, but, I don't know. I've always found that stuff kind of fascinating, although I don't know exactly how. I mean, you know, we can be different people on different days, you know, so.
Yeah, I love that you said that. I don't like the rigidity. I don't know if the test itself is rigid, but I don't like the rigidity people bring to it because I feel very, I feel like an I who masquerades as an E, and I feel like a, although probably less well than I think I do, and I also feel like a P who has turned into a J. I think a lot of people become J's as they get older, and especially women in a certain way who can't afford to just watch things and not make snap judgments about them for safety reasons.
Wait, did you say that you've never taken it?
I don't think I've ever taken a whole version of it.
Oh, okay.
Or maybe I have.
But it sounds like you know a lot about it.
Yeah, I Google it a lot. I'm into definitions. I'm not into believing them, but I'm into different ways of organizing people and the world.
What do you think makes you curious about that?
I want to know who I am. I think I am into armchair diagnosing. I shouldn't be, but the way a cartoonist does it is, I shouldn't. I try not to, but also I don't know. I really like saying which character in a book I would be. I like drawing comparisons. That's what cartoonists do. And then I'll take a step back and make another comparison. So it's not super rigid. I think the problem I have with things like tarot reading is that you can't get out of this definition that has been assigned to you. I like it more as a thought experiment.
Me too. It's interesting when people take things such as astrology as gospel.
Yeah, I know.
Like, you're such a Leo, or I don't know,
you know.
Whatever.
I love astrology so much. I'm always afraid of wielding it though.
Yeah, I just don't believe in dogma in anything really.
Yeah,
I think there's pieces to the puzzle that will help guide you along the way, but you can't necessarily hold on the piece and try to fit that piece into every single round peg or whatever.
No, you know? and you shouldn't assign value judgments to the pieces either.
Yeah, no, exactly. So I had another question here, but in an interview for New York Magazine, you said that you would love to be invisible. And so I found that connection of words to be really interesting, just the idea of being invisible. And why do you think you're attracted to that?
First of all, I don't think I would want to be invisible if I had to forfeit flying.
you mean as a superpower?
Yeah. just to be clear, I would probably rather fly.
Since we're on superpowers, which one would you want the most? Flying?
No, unfortunately, I'm a true adult, and I would want the one where you could move cars that are parallel parked on the street, just like nudge them forward to make room for yourself to park or for someone else to park.
That's like your only telepathic strength. You can't move other things. You can only move parallel cars.
Yeah. or you could kind of like squish. Maybe I have a car that can get small and can squish between cars. It's a time saving device, most of all. It's an efficiency thing.
I see.
It goes along with the superpower of like being able to do taxes, which I guess is just being an accountant. So I waste my superpower on that. What would you have if you could have any?
I mean, probably flying. Maybe that says something about my ideas of escapism.
Of course I would fly.
Yeah. I don't know. Something about flying. I mean, I certainly wouldn't want to like collide with an airplane or something, but
yeah, there's one. Can you hear one passing me right now?
Oh, it's serendipity.
Oh, I'm flying, I should say. I need to get out of the way.
Oh, okay. Yeah. You're flying. You're currently flying. So
yeah.
You're an insane multitasker who has superpowers.
Yeah. if I accepted flying, like I want to know the logistics of this. If I got a superpower, would everyone in the world also get a superpower? If so, probably prefer the parallel parking one, because I don't think I would enjoy flying if everyone could fly. It would be very crowded.
Yeah, that's interesting.
But I would love to fly. But I guess if everyone were flying, it would just become another thing that I was obsessed over, figuring out the off hours and kind of like going to museums now, which is I wasn't going to museums during the height of COVID for a year, and I started again, although I guess I might stop again. But for a moment there, it was like flying. Like you could go any moment and it wouldn't be too crowded. But now it's back to kind of like doing this big math problem and figuring out, is the Met going to be so crowded on this day? At this time, is it worth the hour and a half trip? And I almost wish I didn't have the superpower of being able to go to the Met at all, because I put so much agony into this decision of when to go.
Is your concern more so about being around people and COVID, or is it more so just about being around people and the anxiety of being around tons of people?
Totally people, just people.
Yeah.
I'm pretty scared of crowds. I don't like I don't know what it is. I don't like multiple people kind of like, I feel like maybe I have kind of a God complex where I feel in charge all the time. So if people are walking in a crowded room, I feel like I need to arrange the chess pieces so they don't bump into each other. And I'm just constantly watchful of all these people. And I get very irritated with people who are either going to walk into me if I don't get out of the way, or even going to walk into each other. And I can't not focus on that. I don't think this is very common. I'm not sure what it is.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's just the way that you intake that sort of information.
Yeah. I also like never look directly at people. I'm afraid of that, which makes them more menacing. If I actually looked at these people's faces, I would probably find them human. But yeah, going back to invisibility, I would feel better in this situation if I were invisible, I think.
In the situation where you're at the Met with in front of a ton of people?
Yeah, exactly. I think that's why. That was a very long way of saying why I would like to be invisible.
What do you think about when you have to do some, you know, interviews in front of people, like a mass audience of people, or, you know, talk about a book and do PR and things like that? Like, what are your thoughts?
A great way to not let people touch you is to be behind a podium or something. So relaxing. Also to just have all the air in the room.
But it does. But you don't freak out at all about public speaking?
No.
Oh.
I freak out about speaking to like a small class, and I also do very, very badly on Zoom for some reason. I'm not sure why, even if it's a lecture or something. So there are situations that I really don't like maybe a book club. I really don't like. I don't like something interactive where I'm ostensibly the speaker, but there are just five other people and they can ask me questions at any time. I don't like organize. I don't like directing other people in how to talk. That doesn't come naturally. I've been teaching a writing workshop at a college, and I like it, but it's very hard, and it makes me very shy to like I'm not doing most of the talking the students are, but I'm kind of the hostess.
You said it's a writing class.
Yeah, I backed out of this coming semester because I'll be having a baby, and I feel really sad to miss it, actually. But I've been teaching every semester for a little while at Farmer.
What sort of writing class is it?
It's personal essays, not my field.
But do you think that by teaching this class, it's challenged you in terms of being able to write longer form sort of things and being able to basically, you know, talk to other people about that?
I don't know. I'm not a good teacher. I wonder if I will. I'm like a very tentative teacher who doesn't have her teaching voice yet, I guess is what I mean. But I've taught comics, and I feel much better when it comes to teaching comics. I'm much better at like having something to look at and talk about. Somehow it's harder to pick out a piece of someone's essay and talk about it than it is to talk. I'm better at talking about style and story, maybe. Anyway, yeah, I don't have a system yet, but I really enjoy reading people's work. They're very good writers. I'm not sure if I make their work better, although maybe if they're very, very good students, they can take something of my total doubt and openness and incorporate that into how they write. But yeah, I wish I were better at being like, this is what needs to change. I'm very good at that on a grammar level, but not on a giant structure level when it comes to writing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you never know what sort of energy that you bring to a class setting and how that can affect the people around you, or in this case, the students. So, you know, it's hard. I mean, it would be hard to say like if, you know, the students are getting certain things out of it or not, or maybe they are, and, you know, that those sort of things will, you know, come full circle for them like 10 years later. So yeah. It's really hard to say. I
have no idea. I also really, I didn't like being a student, so I feel like a total fraud as a teacher. Like, how can you teach if you didn't like learning?
That might be good too, though, because being a student, I mean, I don't know, like, there's some people that are really good at being students, but maybe that's because they like to be told exactly what to do and how to do it. You know?
Yeah, I always had my own thing that I really wanted to work on that never fit into class. And class just felt like this real waste of time to me. Plus, too many people crowded.
Yeah.
Too many noises.
I was curious, like, with your cartoons, what sort of themes, I mean, maybe even within the last couple of weeks or last months or so, what sort of themes have you been encompassing within your artwork? Like, what sort of things and feelings have you been dealing with?
I've been going through some life changes. I'm pregnant, and I've been trying to figure out like what kind of work I can make about that, and about, oh, I just got married. I don't worry so much that I won't have fodder for New Yorker cartoons, which I know people do about being adults, obviously, but my Instagram drawings have always been about being kind of a younger, more single person, like navigating loneliness and the cruelty of like how people treat you on the street, which matters a lot less to me now that I have more of a home circle. Like now I'm much more interested in the agony of navigating life with a partner and a family and a dog. So I'm tentatively trying to figure out if I have anything to say about this and also if anyone will care about it. It's been, I guess, the beginning of like a scattering of self for me. I feel like the pieces have all flown apart. I hope I gather them again somehow.
Well, I mean, there's so many changes that go about in someone's life that I think by embracing those changes and finding some sort of narrative about, you know, the way that you're living life and viewing life in your current state, you know, I think people can find that to be cathartic in a way.
I hope so. Yeah. Instagram's tricky. I don't know if I've shown it a part of myself. I don't know how kind it will be to other parts of myself.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah, there can be a lot of positive things, but a lot of negative things as well. And it seems that the negative things generally affect people more than the positive things.
Yeah, I feel very lucky to have the positive things, but I guess I feel really terrible with the negative things. Like when I say something that hurts a lot of feelings and people write me emails, that's really hard. And I also am so afraid of losing the positive. So I guess that's a way to turn the positive into the negative.
Yeah.
I like feeling seen. I like feeling like I have a platform where I can say anything and not do a lot of judging of myself or expecting other people to judge me, not having to go through editors.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's like a lot of the complicated reality of having a platform that people can view readily. You know, I think you have like 500,000 followers. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, it's like kind of the complicated thing. It's like you like the positive affirmations and they help you in certain ways. And then there's negative things that people, you know, it's hard to sort of sift through all of that, I would assume.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. So, I guess, you know, I'll ask one more question, and, you know, I generally ask this question to everyone that I interview, but, do you have any advice for artists and creatives?
I think try to be clear about what you want from life and from art, and just above all, if it's money, it's money. And if it's not money, it's not money. And don't worry about having a day job, because you can be an equally great artist with a day job. And if it's communication, then maybe it's not exquisite beauty. I think it took me a long time to learn that I cared about communication rather than perfect beauty. Life is long. You will have days and weeks and months and years when you're not feeling very inspired, and you will keep working and maybe you won't, but that's not going to be forever. I guess that's the advice. Also, if you're not feeling connected to your work, it's possible. Like, try to run through a checklist of what it could be, because there might be a concrete reason that won't necessarily be easy to solve, but it'll still be helpful to know. Maybe you don't have the right pen. Maybe you don't have the right story. Maybe you have the right story, but you need to spend 3 months figuring out how to tell it, how to start to tell it.
That's good. I like it.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Well, thanks for taking the time to do this. I really appreciate you for doing this.
Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, thank you. Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in. See you next time.